The topic for today's discussion is managing change. It is covered in Unit 11 of Block 3 of Organization and Management Process course. And this session is useful for both MBA first year and for the students of PG Diploma in Marketing Management of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. The present day organizations, they are working in a very dynamic and ever-changing world. The organizations have to change their work processes, procedures, cultures, products, management style, so on and so forth, as per the changes that are taking place in the environment. Otherwise, it will be highly difficult for them even to exist in the present day's competitive world. Then what is this change? In the context of business, change means any alteration in the overall work environment of an organization. This alteration may be required because of the introduction of a new or substitute product in the market, or because of the changes that are taking place in technology or government policies, or because of the changes that are taking place in the tastes, fashions, the needs, requirements of the customers, etc., etc. The process through which this change will be introduced in the organizations is known as managing change. To know more about this particular concept change, how it will be actually introduced in the organizations, we have two resource persons with us in our studios today. Meet Professor K. Koteswarao, Dean, Faculty of Commerce, and Director for Center for Staff Training and Development of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. Meet another resource person of today's program, Mr. N. Sudhakaramurthy. He is Executive Director at SS3 Consultancy and Training Services Private Limited, Hyderabad. Yeah, Professor Rao, as an academic expert in the field, he will just introduce us the concept of change, and will there be any resistance for the change, and what are the strategies to be followed by the managers to introduce this change in the organizations. And Mr. Murthy, as a practicing consultant, will share his experiences with us. So now let us start the discussion. So Professor Rao, can you please explain us this concept of change more precisely for our students?
Yes. As you have rightly pointed out, change plays a key role both in human life and in organizations. As both organizations and society are interdependent for their survival and progress, let us have the precise meaning of the word change. Change refers to new, unfamiliar, and uncertain dimension involving the policies, procedures, personnel, structures, etc. If you take the policy part, if you take our own university, previously we used to have more focus on the print media.
Yeah.
Now we switched over our focus to non-print media, that is, we are focusing much on radio lessons, video lessons, teleconferencing, telecasting, etc. Likewise, if you take the procedures, we are also distributing the books during the time of admissions instead of sending them to their doorstep. This is a change in our procedure. Like that, we can list out any number of examples for such things. This change is essential for two purposes, that is, for progress and their survival.
So change is a must for the organization.
Yeah.
So in context of business, are there any particular factors that will warrant change?
Yeah, there are two types of factors. Mm-hmm. That is, external category of factors, internal factors. Okay. When you refer to the external factors, we have a number of examples like government policy, government procedures, technology, change in the market situation, tariff policy, tariff procedures. All these are external factors which have their impact on the functioning. Likewise, if you take the internal factors, strategies, technology, when an outsider has come as a chief executive, there might be change in the policies of the organizations. Like that, we can list out any number of factors which are responsible for the change in the organizations.
So, Mr. Sudhakar Murthy, Professor Rao told that both internal and external factors, they actually warrant this change in the organizations. As a consultant, can you please give us a few examples for all these factors, different types of factors?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Kiran Mai.
Yeah.
I find that change can be actually due to two reasons in the practical world. One, we find change because of internal initiative. The other one, we find change because of external pressures. The change due to external pressures is automatic, lack of clarity is there, develops a tremendous amount of anxiety and things like that. Whereas the change that is directed by internal initiative, there will be a vision, there's a clarity, and the people are moving towards that, there's a communication, and this is one type of change. Another thing very important that the corporate world has realized is that change is an instrument of progress. And we have seen that those who have resisted it have been cast aside by a march of forces beyond their control. And the wiser companies, they've accepted change as a dynamic force which can help them move forward. And we see these are few organizations that have succeeded. Apart from these two points, I would also like to say that in the practical world, we are not really just trying to look at coping up with change or managing ourselves with change. The concept of change management really is a question mark. Can we really manage change is an issue. I think the issue is how do we manage ourselves in order to really lead the change or master the change. So the issue is not just about initiating change or sustaining change, but the issue is one of about mastering the change or leading the change. Now, how do you go about this? If we look at some of the examples of change where it has taken place because of a compulsion, let us say suddenly an organization has come to a loss. For example, yes. Voltas, in 96-97, you see that they've entered into a loss of about 17 crores. Suddenly now we find that what needs to be done. There are a lot of change efforts taking place in Voltas. And then we find that, you know, they're in a lot of soup. But of course, outsiders coming in is another issue Professor Rao has mentioned.
Yes.
We had in Voltas, Mr. Sarin, R.C. Sarin, who came over as a chief executive, but he was there in the culture for about 1.5 years. While he was there, certain amount of changes were introduced, but then he could not fit in with the culture. We saw that the person has moved out, but still the benefits of the person coming into the organization in terms of bringing in precise accountability in the organization has become possible. So some of these examples really substantiate. One more aspect I would like to say about change before I really conclude on this particular issue of yours is, we find that Professor Rao has mentioned external factors and internal factors. The third one I would like to add is the future aspirations of the organizations themselves, which are the internal initiative. Many of the companies, like for example, Telco, Ranbaxy, Dr. Reddy's Lab, NIIT, you'll find that they have been no really in competition. They've been number one in the competition, yet they've been going ahead with a lot of changes in their organizations with the internal initiative. So I think if you look at the external factors in the practical world, we put it in terms of three C's. One, the customer. Two, the competition. Three, the change. Change could be social, political, economical, or technological. And when we come to the internal, we look at practical corporations which are going into change, the internal pressures or changes in processes of the organization, which could be operational and managerial. The second one, the restructuring, which you have seen in many companies that have taken place. And thirdly, the systems. And lastly, people and culture. So these are the things that we find in the external and internal. And when we come to the aspirations of the future of the organization, that is where we see the role of the leadership, the role of visionary leadership, trying to create a clear vision of where the organization would like to reach in future, not just trying to cope up or manage themselves with the external change, but leading the external change, mastering and creating, becoming trendsetters.
So according to you, it is a customers, competition, change, restructuring processes, the policies, cultures, role of leadership, all these are responsible introducing change
That's
in the organizations. But whenever some change is introduced in the organizations, some change may take place with regard to the roles and responsibilities of the employees and others. So do the employees, do they accept all these changes without any resistance?
Possibility of resisting the change due to many reasons. As we observe in the organizations, that maybe on individual reasons, that may be on organizational reasons. When we talk about individual reasons, Normally, what happens is that may be due to obsolescence of skills or due to economic loss, they may expect due to this change, they may be losing financially.
Yes.
That's how they may resist sometimes. And another is personal reasons, like they may sometimes lose the relationships because of breaking the work groups due to this change. And sometimes, over and above all these things, peers' pressure would also be there. That's how,
yeah.
Though they are willing to accept the change, sometimes due to their friends, they yield to the pressure and they may resist the change. When you come to the organizational pressures or organizational factors for resisting the change, normally there are so many things. That is, the change which may bring in some changes in the existing structural aspects, which may reduce the power of the individuals, which may reduce the influence of the individuals. Like that, there may be funds constraint for the organizations. If at all, if we go for the change in the organizations, there is a need for the introduction of change, either in factors of personal or machinery or technology or some other thing, then normally, due to this funds constraint, they may resist the change. And another thing is, when most of their funds are locked in the form of fixed assets, then normally the organization may not be able to cope up for the requirements of the change. So these are some of the reasons which cause resistance to the introduction of change in the organizations.
So, Mr. Murthy, what are your experiences with this particular aspect?
Yeah, maybe I would like to start with an obvious quotation, which is from my experience that I've developed. No person changes for the sake of others. It's very true, whether it's an organization, in human nature, we find that. And a person changes only when the person wants to. And when does the person want to change? A person wants to change only for the sake of his own or her own true desire. Now, if we want to bring about this type of a change in the organization, which consists of tremendous number of people, I think one of the very important things that the challenge lies with the corporations which they are really looking at is how to evolve a collective own true desire, which we call in managerial terms the shared vision. So therefore, it is the people who resist change, but it is the people themselves who initiate change and also sustain change. So we'll have to bring before them a dissatisfaction with the present. In practice, what we have done in many of the organizations where we have worked, we have tried to create a dissatisfaction with the present. Now, you may ask me, how do you create this dissatisfaction with the present? And we found that whenever you create an awareness in people, generate knowledge in people, you find that this additional knowledge, new knowledge, creates a sort of a dissatisfaction with the present. And once this dissatisfaction with the present is created, it is like ungluing them from the status quo situation to which they are stuck up. But then the people who are unglued are more harmful than the people who are stuck to a place. So the next thing we find is what we have done is we create a vision of the future which is better than the present. So once we create this vision of the future which is better than the present, there is a desire or an urge that is created amongst the people. Once this urge is aroused, then people are very eager to change. In fact, we find there is a proactive nature of behavior from the people in the organization. But then, as Professor Rao has mentioned very clearly, there are a lot of fears. There are a lot of fears. So I think these fears have to be eliminated. That is where we found the role of the leaders is very, very, very vital. And communication is very important. So leadership, vision, communication of the vision, and that will give the courage. The fear is eliminated by the leaders and communication process, and then we see that the first few steps in the direction of the vision are taken by the organization. Once these first few steps are taken, we make it a point to celebrate even the minutest achievements that have been done, so that achievement creates more urge to achieve. So once we have seen that we have achieved something, then it happens. Even Stephen Covey, in his book of Seven Habits, he talks about how to create a habit. That's like change. So that's what we are saying. Knowledge, what to do and why to do. Desire, the want to do, and the skills, how to do. So this is where in how to do, the awareness, training and development, education of the people is a very vital responsibility of the management in bringing about this change. So these three things will take you to awareness, acceptance, and action. And therefore, I think this is the model that we follow to break the resistance. One more point, if I can add, we find that there are, in any group of organization, transforming an organization or changing does not mean that we have to literally change all the 10,000 or 20,000 employees. We find there are groups, people who are supporting change, people who are resisting change. And people who support change are, let's say, 10% of the group. People who oppose change, there are, let us say, about 20% of the group. Now, our job is how do we really increase this, tilt this balance of 10% to become more than 20 or decrease the 20. And the balance 70 which are there in the middle, they are basically neutral people. They tilt the way wherever the maximum is. So this is what we do practically in organizations.
Why there is resistance for change? Already you explained a lot about different reasons for resistance.
I'm sorry. There are many reasons I have already explained, both individual and organizational.
Now, Mr. Murthy.
Okay, you can see some past issues of business today, which will show the evidence of what I'm saying now. If you look at the company called Mahindra & Mahindra, they have taken up what is called as a Top Gear shop floor program. And if you look at this particular thing, in the utility sector or the commercial vehicle sector, Mahindra & Mahindra is the leading in the competition in our country. But yet, when they were doing very well, they have taken steps because of internal urge in order to create a beautiful future for themselves in the a beautiful vision they have of the future. So in order to overcome the resistance of trade unions, instead of normally the practice which is there that the chief executives and the top battalion really goes abroad and sees what's happening there and trying to come back and tell people as to what exactly the organizations must do, what they have done is they have actually taken the trade union office bearers and the people at the operating level on the shop floor, and they've been sent to Lucas in London, and they've really gone and operated there and seen what exactly the scenario is. Now when they've come back, there is no resistance to change. In fact, I think the resistance to change is from the management, not from the trade union or workers. There is a pressure from the bottom actually to come up, bring about the change in as fast time as possible.
Yes, please. Mr. Murthy, the position of human relations.
The position of human resources is very vital because ultimately the technology has to be handled by the people and accepted by the people. So I think even responding to your question and the earlier question, the point is if Mr. Ashok Gajapati Raju has got a cabinet committee formed in terms of how to use the electronic media, I think that is a top-down approach according to what Professor Rao has been telling. We need to also couple it with a bottom-up approach where we create an awareness among the people to really switch on their TVs and see what can be done, how they can utilize it for their own benefit. Unless the combination of top-down approach and the bottoms-up approach in terms of the awareness to the people as to what the benefits are of going into technology, then I think it will be very useful. In the short term, it may appear to be not a welfare to the people, but in the long term, this is the right thing to do. Only thing I can say to you is you have to introspect on this particular small statement which I make. That is, should you give a fish to a hungry man or teach him how to fish? I think when we get into the private sector, all the people are the same. The people in the public sector only will be there, but only thing their way, attitude and approach will change because they are more accountable. That's what I feel.
Western countries model India Kelapankos.
You see, the model is prepared on the basis of the environment. I agree with your question. But some of the principles we can take, and depending upon our environment, we can make a model and use it. Say, for example, take our own distance education. This distance education is started in UK, which suits the environment of UK and other countries. Now we are using it by modifying the principles which would suit the existing environment of India. That's how we can make use of the Western models also.
Dr. Kirama, if I can just add.
Yeah.
I don't think we can give offhand solutions for such things on this program. But if I may continue with what I was saying.
Yeah.
The point is that if you look at the model that we talked about, creating dissatisfaction with the present, creating a vision of the future, and trying to take the first few steps in the direction of the vision, we see that basically this is an Indian model which is called as the Shakti Traya, where you see, they said that the coupling of three forces, that is the Jnana Shakti, which is nothing but knowledge, and the Ichha Shakti, which is nothing but the desire or inner urge, and the Kriya Shakti, which is nothing but the first few steps in the direction of vision. So you see that most of the models which the Westerners are coming out today are very, very relevant and basically founded on Indian ethos. So if at all anybody can implement these models, I think India would be number one in implementing these models. Just to add one more point, another very recent model that we talked about is re-engineering.
There is a need to change in their attitudes first. So by changing their attitudes, first they have to take the lessons from the Western environment. There are certain differences between the Western employees and Indian employees. In Western cases, there is no job security, there is no uniformity in scales. All these things play a key role in their progress. Likewise, here also, unless we introduce such type of accountability on the part of the employee, taking all these conditions into account, we have to come out with a model which would be suitable to the needs of the introduction of this change. So then only it will be successful. So for revolutionary or evolutionary, that depends upon the size of the organization, time available, and other things.
If you go back to what exactly I talked about, the change, how we can bring about, we said that we need to have a vision which must be shared. Communication is an important process through which you have to share this vision. And if we can unify the individual urge which is there for what his organization should do and the organization's vision, if they both are coupled together and if you can create harmony or a commonness of purpose, then I think this problem can be resolved.
When we start introducing change in the organizations, if we start with individual change, first of all, we have to change the knowledge and attitude of the employees working in the organization. That's how, for changing the knowledge, we have to make use of the psychology and other things so that we can get in the necessary change in the minds of the, or in the mindset of the employees, so that we can successfully implement the change in the organizations.
So from this discussion, it is clear that the change is a must for the organizations because it is the only certain thing in the present day environment. So thank you very much, Professor Koteswar Rao and Mr. Sudhakar Murthy, for participating and for sharing a lot of information for our students. So if you have any more questions, please write to the Dean of the Faculty or Head of the Department for Business Management for further clarifications.